Hi there folks. About 3 years ago, I put together a video on how to create an Excel file in Power Automate, and it's probably one of my most viewed videos. But since then, I've learned an awful lot, and I've recently seen a video by Reza Durrani, no surprises, showing you how to create an Excel file using the existing create file action, but doing so in OneDrive. So this video is going to show you how to do the same in SharePoint. I'm also going to show you how to build out a flow that will dynamically either create a brand new file if the file doesn't exist, adding a table to it so you can add your data into that file, or update an existing file if, of course, that file already exists, and you'll see that later on in the demonstration, as well as may be surprising to you how much money I might make from a video or how little I might make, as that's often a question I'm asked when I'm attending various community events. So over on SharePoint, I have an empty document library. Over on Power Automate, I have a very basic flow with a manual trigger. And by adding a simple single action, which is the create file action for SharePoint rather than OneDrive, although this works in both OneDrive and in SharePoint, I can then select my document library, in this case my November 2024. I can select my folder path, which is my shared documents, my default document library. The name of the file I can make dynamic, and I quite like to use UTC Now. And the advantage of UTC Now is that you can also specify the format of the date. And in this case, I'd actually like to have a monthly file created. So I'm going to go with, in single quote, four uppercase M's, which will give me the full month. Now by adding that in, all I need to do now is add a file extension to the end, which is XLSX. And then in terms of the file content, in my first ever video, I showed you using a template file to populate that content. Lo and behold, if you add in a space like so, that's all you need to create a blank Excel file via Power Automate. So if I publish and test that flow and jump over onto my SharePoint site, if I hit refresh, we can see a brand new file has been created. And when I open that file, we have a blank Excel file ready for us to write data to it. Now, if I quickly jump across onto Reza's video, you can see he's created a file in exactly the same method, using a file space in order to create the file on OneDrive. But you're probably wondering, why did he do it on OneDrive and not on SharePoint? Well, if I zoom through the video and jump to about 11 minutes, you can see he's using an action send an HTTP request. And that HTTP request is in fact a standard action. And with this standard action, you can use the Graph API to write data to the me endpoint on the Graph API, which then allow you to write data to Excel in bulk. So by creating a file on OneDrive, you can then use the me endpoint, which can access your files on your OneDrive, to then write data to Excel in bulk. But there are other methods, and I've got videos showing you how you can use the premium connector for exactly the same method using the Graph API, but also you can write yourself an office script. And that office script can write 20,000 records to a file in 10 seconds or less. And I'll share that link in the description for you to watch later on. You'll also see in that video another method for creating a brand new Excel file. Now, if we look at the stats of the video that I created almost 3.5 years ago, you'll see that it's had almost 122,000 views. And for me, that's absolutely amazing and overwhelming to think that's helped so many people. It's been watched for 8,600 hours and got me 600 subscribers. So needless to say, I'm hoping this video is just as popular. But in terms of revenue, it's brought in £560 to my channel. Of course, I pay tax on that too. By comparison, if I jump across to again what I consider to be a very popular video showing you how to compare arrays without using an apply to each, this is a very, very efficient method for comparing arrays. It's got 16,400 views, only 1,300 hours and £71, which is why recently I've introduced a membership on my channel, which for $2.99 you can subscribe to for as long as you want. Your name will appear, and if I see any nice comments from you guys, I'll give you a shout out. So I'd like to thank Tim Lawler, who's already spotted my new memberships that I've set up. So thanks very much for joining just over 3 weeks ago. So jumping back onto Power Automate, when I built this initially, it's based on creating a file based on the month of the year. So in this case, November. And I thought I'd try and extend this use case to demonstrate how we could create some logic that When we write data to this Excel file, depending on where that's coming from, if it's a Microsoft form or a third-party system, we're going to, first of all, check to see if the file for this month exists. If it does, fine, we can add a row to an existing table. But if it doesn't, we can create a file, we can add a table, and we can add a row into that file. So this is perfect if you want to have a file for every month, maybe even a file for every day or every week. But using this logic, you'll be able to then build out this process and dynamically either create a brand new Excel or use the existing file that exists in your SharePoint document library. So if I jump back into Edit, the first piece of logic that I need to create is an action to get the file properties. And by doing so, I can do a filter on the files in a document library. So again, with the get files action, if I set up the document library, if I choose the library name, in this case, the documents, which is the default document library, and then under the advanced parameters, we have a filter query. And so I'll add that in, and here I can build out a filter query based on the file name. Now, instinctively, you might want to use title, you might want to use name. In fact, there is a system name that sits behind the scenes called file leaf ref. That's right, you heard me correctly. It is file, leaf, and then ref. And we're going to check to see if that equals, so EQ, and then in single quotes, the name of the file that we're checking. So in this case, it's going to be based on an expression, which will be UTC now, with the open and close brackets, and in single quotes, the four M's, because we're going to check to see if the file with this month exists in that folder path. So I'll add that in. I need to make sure that I add in the file extension, XLSX. And then with that in place, we're going to then add in a condition. So the condition is going to check to see, do we get any results back from that filter? So here we've added in our condition block, and the value that we want to check is going to be based on the length. So again, if I click on FX, I can type in length, and I can choose dynamic content. So what we're looking for here is the body value from the get files. So get files will get all the files that match the filter. We've got one file that we're looking for. If it exists, it will be returned in the body value, which is an array or a table of data. And so this length expression will check the length. If it's one, then of course we've found a file. If it's not one, if it's zero, then we've not found a file. So by adding that in, we can set the second part of our condition to zero, and therefore if the length is equal to zero, then there is no file, we need to create it. I can bring that create file action up, and if it does exist, then obviously we can add a row to an existing table. But now we need to build out the logic that'll either create a table or add to an existing table. So of course, if I want to build out this logic further, I need to have some input parameters. That could come from an API, but for the purpose of this demo, I'm going to add in some input parameters onto my trigger, and we will have the name as an input parameter. We can have a date, and I'll call that work date. And we can also add in another piece of text for the work summary. Now, of course, this could all come from a Microsoft form or a Power app, but for the purpose of the demo, because it's a manual trigger, when I run it, it'll ask me for those input parameters and I can pass them dynamically into the table that I create or into the file if it already exists. So underneath the create a file action, we're going to need to add in a create a table action. And by selecting that, I need to set up the defaults for the location and the document library. And then in terms of the file, it's actually going to be based on a dynamic value. So based on the create file, we want to get the body ID. When it comes to the table range, that's the number of columns that we want to have in our new table. And because I know there are three columns, I'm going to enter A1 to C1. When it comes to the other parameters we need to set here, we have the table name and the column names. The table name is based on whether or not you want to set a new table as a default, otherwise it'll be called table one. The column names are important if you want to have specific column names. And of course, I want to have the name, the work date, and also the work summary. Now with that in place, what I want to do now is to add a row into a table. And I can select the action, fill in those default values for the location and document library. Again, the file is dynamic, it's based on the ID. So if I search for ID, the the body ID of that create file action. The table is something that I can't select dynamically, so I need to enter in a custom value. And because I haven't overwritten the default table name, it will be called table one. In the advanced properties, as soon as I've entered that table name, there is a row property, and that's looking for an object. So using squiggly brackets, open and closed, I can then insert the names of those columns and the dynamic data. Now, if you've already forgotten the names of those columns, which I have, you can actually use a feature in the new designer where you right click on an action and you pin it. And by pinning it, I now have the create table action alongside the add a row into a table action, and I can now see those column names. So name, work date, and work summary. So in quotes, I'll put in name, I'll then put in work date, and then finally work summary. I don't believe these things are case sensitive, so I'm going to leave the name with a lowercase n. And then after each of those keys, as they're called, you put in a semicolon. And then after each of those semicolons, double quotes, for the work date, I believe dates can be left without quotes. And with the work summary, it's a string. So again, I'll put it in quotes. And then the only other thing you need to make sure you complete this object structure is commas after each of the values. So at the moment there are no values, but I need to insert those commas after each line. I now have a valid object and I can start inserting the dynamic value. So in those quotes for the name, I can come into the search for name, and if I scroll down, I can get the dynamic value for name. Of course, this could come from your Power App, your Microsoft Form, etc. In the work date, just in front of that comma, I'll go and search for date, and I can get the work date value. And in the work summary, of course, dynamic values, if I search for summary, I can insert the work summary. With that now set up, I'm going to remove the pin from the create table. And if I have a look at the advanced parameters, you can see we have something called the date time format. And by selecting that, I can choose the default behavior, which is the ISO 8601, because the date that I'm going to be capturing via the input should be in the ISO 6801, and therefore it should be passed across into Excel in that format so that it writes it as a date in my new table. So with that all in place, let's do a save and test. When the flow runs, it has input parameters. I can type in my name, I can choose my work date, and I'll say it was Friday the 1st of November, and I will say working with client X. But before I hit the run flow action, remember, jumping back onto the SharePoint site, I already have a file called November. So I need to delete this because I want this flow to create a brand new November file. And at the moment, that's the only logic I've got. So when I run this, the flow history is playing out as expected. We're doing a get files. If we look at the outputs of the get files, the value array is empty. Therefore, the length will be equal to zero. It comes down the left-hand side. It creates a brand new Excel file called November XLS. It creates a table in there, and then it adds a row into that table. And if I pop open the input, we can see the dynamic content is being passed into that table. The proof is always in the pudding. So if I jump across onto my SharePoint document library and open up that November file, and I'll eat my words, it must be case sensitive because our name is empty, the work date is empty, but the work summary has working with client X, and clearly I've got a lowercase n and a lowercase w for work date. So I'll go and edit and test that. Change it to uppercase N, change it to uppercase W. I'll delete that original file again, and we can use the previous run. When we look at the history and look at the raw input, we can see we now have the uppercase for name and work date. And if I jump back across into SharePoint, load up that new Excel file, we now have my name, the work date, and my work summary. So everything working as expected. So let's now go and work on the right-hand side branch, where if the file already exists, we can add a row into an existing table. So if we now go into the right-hand branch and add in an action, we can get a file using a path. And rather than getting file content, all we need is the file metadata. And in here, we can select the default document library, which is my November 2024. And the file path we're going to create dynamically. But for the purpose of just demonstration here, if I go and select a fixed file, I can navigate to that shared document to my November file. We can see how that file path is constructed. Now, the bit that's meant to be dynamic is this November. So if I delete that, I can then go into inserting an expression, and I can again use UTC now and in single quotes put in those four M's. And so that now gives me that file name dynamically. I notice it's removed the forward slash, so I need to insert that forward slash there after the shared documents. But that file path is now dynamic based on that November file path. So what will happen now, if the file doesn't exist, we've seen already, we'll create a new file, create a table and add a row. But if the file does exist, based on this condition that we have, the length is equal to zero, then we're going to get the file metadata using a path, and then very similar to the left hand, we're going to add a row into a table. And so what I might do here is, I'll right click on that action, I'll copy it, I'll go into the plus, I'll paste in the action. Everything is set up like it was before, but the only thing I need to change now is this ID, because of course this is based on the create file action in the left hand branch, but I want it to be based on the get file metadata using path. So again, I was going to search for ID, I can already see it, but there we go, the body ID from the get file metadata using path, and we can now add a row into that table based on that dynamic data. And we've now completed our flow. So with the flow now in test mode, if I put in some more data, we've got Alex, who worked on Thursday the 31st. Their work summary was to tidy up the client documents, and I'll run that flow. What should happen is it will get files. We'll have a look at the output here. We can see that within the raw output, if we scroll down, within body value, we have a record being returned because of course it's looked for a file called November XLSX. That file exists, and because it exists, the length will not be equal to zero. Therefore, it will not go down the left-hand side and create a brand new file. Instead, it goes down the right-hand side. It gets the file using the file path, which is here, based on the dynamic value we created. And then it's adding a row into a table. If I go into that original Excel file, we can see already that Alex entry has been added into that file based on that logic. Now, if I was to go back into this document library and I was to delete this file, it's the beginning of a new month. We have no November file. When I run it for Betty, who did some work on the 5th of November, which is now in the future, signed a new deal with a big client. And if I run that, because the file doesn't exist, what I hope to see is it will branch down the left-hand side. Again, get files. If we look at the raw output, we'll be able to see that the body value is indeed empty. And because it's empty, the length is equal to zero. We create a file, we create a table, and we add that row into the table. If I run it a second time, and it's Charlie, who was doing some work on the 4th of November, working on my accounts, and hit run flow, of course, it's going to branch right because that file already exists for November. We're going to get the file metadata and then we're going to add a row. And then if I jump across onto SharePoint, load up that file, we can see that as well as Betty, we have Charlie, and their data has been entered into that new table, which was a new file created dynamically based on the month of November. So as always, I hope you got plenty from that video. If you haven't already, make sure you like and subscribe. If you'd like to be a member and mention the channel, check out my membership, but also feel free to buy me a coffee. Equally, I'm quite interested in the concept of creating a community. It will be subscription-based, but if that's something you think is of interest to you, let me know in the comments, let me know via my community tab, and maybe we can get something up and running so we can share and learn about automation and agents in our own community. Thanks very much for watching, and I look forward to seeing you again sometime soon. Cheers.